tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Johnson. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hear him say! Hey! Well done.
A little change from our usual.
Yeah, we coming in worshipy today.
A little different from the hardcore praise fest, but nice nonetheless.
It is. What's up, everybody? You are here, of course, at the Preachers of L.A. After Show. I am your host, Lim Gonsalvez, and I am here with the one, the only.
Only.
The incomparable.
Incomparable.
Miss Tiffany Williams.
That's right. What's up, everybody? Just me and you tonight, Lim.
We hanging out. And it's Dietrich singing his song, Well Done. One of his great hits.
One of his great gospel songs.
It is. And he's kind of, you know, crossing over a little bit and the key word is trying. But we're going to get into that. But first off, let's talk about this gang summit. So basically, the title of this episode was Increase the Peace.
Yep.
And it is because of a gang summit that, and we've heard about this throughout, you know, the episodes, that this is something that was on Ron's heart, Ron Gibson, Bishop Gibson, and that he wanted to do in kind of the imperial courts where he was raised,
right,
where he grew up and where he lived a large portion of his life. And he wanted to go back and kind of, you know, bring back, he wanted to do some speaking there and just kind of reach out to the people that were there. So we got to see it, and it pretty much encompassed the entire episode.
I was kind of confused about this one because this isn't the same gang summit that him and Noel and the other preachers are planning, or is it?
No. Well, the pastors were doing is they were reaching LA. Remember, it was Preach LA, and
right,
then Ron Gibson was Reach LA. I think Ron was doing a component of that,
okay,
which was like a gang component. But this is a separate entity from that endeavor.
So we'll see another gang outreach sort of thing happening later in the season.
I think it'll be part of the larger thing.
Program.
I think it's just a component, which is, you know, how Noel Jones is heading it up, of course.
Right.
And I think that's why he really wanted Ron, because he can reach out to those members. So I think it was just going to be a portion of it. But yeah, this is something totally different. It sounds like it was something that Ron was, you know, kind of spearheading along with some of the other community leaders that were there. And there was a lot going on. Sister Soldier, which was at the forefront of this, and her story kept getting brought up a lot. She lost two sons like within 3 months of each other, which is very sad.
Very sad.
Very sad. At least one of them was not even a gang member, which,
right,
when they first started talking about it, I was like, okay, they were both gang members, but one wasn't even a gang member.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's very sad. And so she was kind of giving her story, and they were kind of talking about her story a lot throughout the episode. So as a whole, being that this is a gang summit, do you think that based on what we saw, what they showed us, do you think that they made some progress? Do you think that there was something that was done? Like, do you think it bettered the community? What do you think?
I think we had to jump several hurdles this episode to get to the core of what they meant to do.
Right.
Like the first strike, being a pastor starting problems when he's there to fix problems. Like, what the heck are you thinking, Bishop Gibson?
Yeah.
Why are you starting fights with people?
See, I was trying to hold out for that, but you know.
This is the heart of this gang summit.
I was trying to wait for that. So yeah, so let's get into that. So like we said, Ron Gibson is there. He has, like I said, the community leaders there that are helping him with this, and they're marching. And basically, there's a scene where he's walking with some of the people that he's with, and there's a guy, and his name is Loco,
right,
as we find out. And he's kind of taunting
He
Bishop
comes
Gibson.
Up behind him right, and his crew with cameras.
Right, with cameras, right.
And they're like saying, you are not from here.
Right.
You're basically an imposter.
Right. They called him, they said he was a fraud. basically, that he's being fraud. Kind of like a tone that if you would see somebody coming in that has a lot of money that would come into an urban area and try to act like oh, I'm from here and I'm, you know, which does happen. And I think he was maybe trying to expose him. And I think the whole thing was because, as we find out, Ron hasn't been there in years.
Right.
He hasn't been around there, and even said that he was talking about Watts riots back in the 60s.
Right.
So we're in 2014 right now. So I think what happened was he's been gone. This guy, he was gone long before this guy was even born.
4 years or something.
Yeah, well, he was saying this. He was gone longer than this guy was even born. Like, he was gone already when this guy even came on the scene, mm-hmm. this guy Loco. So this guy know nothing about Ron Gibson. So he, you know, just kind of taunting, which was rude. Let's keep it real. It was rude.
OG Gibson. Yeah. Was it rude, though?
I think he was being rude. Here's Ron. He's there, you know, for the betterment of the community.
Right.
I think this guy just, you know, this is his hood. This is where he's from, what have you. And I think he was more or less in his own way trying to protect what was going on
in
the sense that
he's trying to protect his neighborhood. He's like a gatekeeper
for the
neighborhood.
Right.
And I can see him. I'm going to have to side with Loco on this one.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Shocker. I'm siding with Loco. but I thought he was, okay, his approach may have been wrong.
Right.
But I can see him wanting to protect his neighborhood, because
right.
you get these people, especially in L.A.,
right.
that just want to come for the cameras. Like,
right.
you haven't been here without the cameras. Why
right.
are you here now with all these people
right.
looking? I don't trust you. That's
no.
not genuine.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we've talked about that, you know, especially with Bishop Gibson, because we've seen that, like, with his niece and his great nephews, and how he, like, oh, okay, let me have him come live with me, and all these things that's happened throughout the season that, why didn't this happen before?
Do you think he would have done that gang thing without the cameras around, or was the show a motivation to go back to his community?
I think the show was definitely a motivation.
He wouldn't have been there without the camera.
I don't know that he wouldn't have been there, but it wouldn't have been to this degree. And it wasn't like it was a huge turnout either,
mm-hmm.
but I think the cameras definitely motivated him going there, because what it does is it puts him in a good light, seeing like, oh, okay, I'm going to go and I'm going to reach out to my community and I'm going to be there for them. And hey, come along and film me doing this.
Mm-hmm.
But the cameras were there. We did see him kind of wild out, which I was very surprised. I mean, here he is. And
but he's an OG, though.
I know, but at the same token, he's an OG, but he's also a bishop now.
Right.
This is not a lifestyle that he's lived for years. And I think it was good that his friend and his wife put him in check and kind of like let him know, because basically he came at dude, and dude didn't come at him aggressively in the sense like, I'm gonna hurt you.
It was confrontation.
You know, he was taunting him.
Yeah.
He was taunting him. He was by his side. He didn't ever get in his face. But Ron Gibson, he basically like, what are you talking about? I'm from here. And he's like, dude's like, I'm not from here. And if you saw, he's kind of standing his ground. Ron Gibson was the one that approached him.
Mm-hmm.
And then once he approached him, then the guy was like, hey, you better back up. And then Ron, of course, feeling his manhood or whatever.
He got all up in his manhood.
He did.
Short manhood, every little card he could pull.
You know, and I think maybe some of that is, you know, Napoleon complex. I don't know, because he is a shorter man.
Right.
And he feels like, you know, maybe he had to defend himself a lot when he was younger. Who knows? But the bottom line is he was the aggressor. He became the aggressor. He came at dude. And then, of course, they had to break it up. And my thing is, because he was the one that was supposed to be leading this, keeping the peace, he's the one that's not bringing the peace.
Right.
He's bringing chaos, which he did state later. And I do appreciate the fact that he did go to him and apologize. I think it took a lot for him to do so, because...
Mm-hmm. Well, he was like, how would you handle it? How would you handle it, Lem, if someone was... if you were there for positive things and mm-hmm. someone came up to you like that, how would you approach it?
What I would do is, if someone came at me like that, I would, you know, approach them in a way that wasn't confrontational.
Hold them to the side.
Exactly. Like, hey, let me highlight you. Hey, what's going on? Like,
right.
what's the issue? Like, find out why they're doing. Because there's obviously usually a reason behind. He doesn't just want to get up there and taunt him for no reason.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason behind it. So find out what the reason was and then say, oh, man, it was not even like that. I'm from here. We're doing this gang summit. You know, he did that afterwards,
right.
which he could have done that in the first place. But the whole thing was he immediately, his old flesh, you know what the church people say, your flesh got a hold of him, and that old man rose up, and he was ready to, like, what's up? You
right.
know what I'm saying? Defend his self or his honor or whatever.
Luckily, he did have good people around him.
Right.
And Sister Soldier definitely jumped in there too. She's like, this is in the name of my son. You're going to apologize right now.
Exactly.
I would have been so embarrassed though. How out of character is that? But it was commendable for him to go over and right his wrong. And then when he did get a chance to talk to Loco, we find out that Loco is actually, I thought he was a pretty intelligent young man.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like, he seemed very well spoken, very aware of what he was doing. Like, he's not crazy.
Absolutely. And when he was talking to him, his thing was, he was like, he was about the youth.
Right.
He's like, we need to change these youth. We need to get to these youth that are going on because they are the ones that are the most impressionable. As we saw, one of the other gentlemen that Ron had actually prayed for and Jay Hayslip prayed for in one of the couple of seasons when they were out there kind of witnessing, he came around and this guy, he said he was currently in a gang. And he got in when he was 10.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like they get in so young. And it's like if the young men don't have any role models or don't have anything to do outside of what's going on, that's what they're going to turn to because that's all they have. You know, a lot of them, the fathers are not in the home. So there's no father figure.
Right.
So they're being raised by a single mother. And then, you know, the streets end up teaching them. And so they go to the streets and that's why they get them caught up because that is their sense of family. But if they had better role models and people to go out there and have some mentoring programs or whatever, you know, which I thought was good that Jay did because he was also part of this in another area where he was giving out skateboards and he had Pro Skater there, which is one of the ministers in his church, Christian Hosoi, who, you know, is a pro skater and they ministered to him.
Right.
And they gave him skateboards and you saw him skating around and falling. And, you know,
I was a little nervous. I'm like, y'all gonna give all these kids skateboards? You're not going to give them. What about the helmets? Knee pads?
I was like, you're going to give.
That's like a liability.
Right, right. I'm like, all these kids from the hood on skateboards. Going around. Just, I'm like, one kid, you see the one kid, he's like, wow, he's amazing. He just goes at, no, he's going to kill himself.
He's going to kill himself, and it's going to be your fault. The next time you see that guy, he's going to have a neck
brace
on.
Right, right. Yeah, that was hilarious.
But they were happy.
They were.
But
they
did seem like there was a low turnout to this whole event.
Yeah.
They needed Lavette.
Yeah. Well, Lavette was there.
Loretta.
Oh,
they needed Loretta to help spearhead that event,
right,
to get some good publicity going.
Yeah, I thought when I saw, like, kind of when they panned out, and I think it was after they would marched and they were at the place where one of the gentlemen gave a really heartfelt speech because one of the kids, one of Sister Soldier's sons, died right in that spot.
In that spot.
Which was horrific. But they were talking about that and then you see him pan out and you see everybody that's there and I'm like,
It's like a handful.
Yeah. I'm like, but at the end of the day, you know, you got to plant a seed.
Right.
And so I don't think the low turnout really showed, you know, how well it went. I think it was important that they did it at the end of the day, no matter what happened, that they planted this seed, that they were there, that they were talking about peace and hopefully spark some change. I did like the fact that we saw some of the other people that we've seen in previous episodes, like the one, I cannot think of her name. I meant to write it down. That was talking about
who married the Crip.
Exactly.
The blood who married the Crip.
Blood who married the Crip. And she was like, yeah, I'm not all the way out yet, but I'm working on
it. She had her purse on her shoulder. giving her speech. Right. She was like,
she knows what's up.
Let me just say this real quick.
Real quick, because I got to go. But yeah, we saw interesting stories, a lot of people, you know, just talking about their past and kind of just giving their testimony in a sense to the people that were there. And for the sole purpose of saying, do not go down this road.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a road you want to go down. And I think it's important that they do that and that we do that as a community. And that I hope that, you know, whether this keeps going on or, I mean, I hope that it spawns something that they could see, okay, this works. Let's continue doing this. Let's keep bringing this awareness because, you know, at the end of the day, these is Preachers of L.A.
Right.
And they are called to reach the masses.
And it's all about visibility.
Right.
And even if they aren't, you know, doing some grand thing,
mm-hmm.
they are showing people another way of living life and what good can come out of stopping the violent lifestyle of the streets. So amen to them.
Amen.
And good for them for even taking the time out of their schedule. Like,
absolutely.
To do that. I wish all of the pastors were there, but I guess we'll see that in the big finale.
Right, when they have the Preach L.A. The Preach L.A.
Reach L.A.
Right, well, that's the... I do want to talk about Ron. I think there's never an episode that goes by that he doesn't have one of his Ron-isms.
I'll give us some.
And so he said, I'm not new to it. I'm true to it. Yes. And then he like did a double, because then right after that he said, if a brother know better, they would do better.
I just wonder if they,
I mean,
if people receive him. Because, like, when I was watching Jay do his little speech, it was a bunch of little kids. Like, they weren't paying attention. They were like, give us the skateboards. Shut
up. I mean, but that's kids, though. I mean, you know, their attention span, if you're ever with a teacher or anything in school, you know it's very hard to keep a child's attention.
Okay, and the same in the streets. Like, you can't be doing nursery rhymes and you on the streets of the imperial courts.
That's Ron's thing. That's what he does. I mean, I think he's just always going to be that way. I mean, I think overall, aside from, of course, what happened, you know, when he kind of had his moment, you know, the fact that he apologized, you know, he humbled himself. I know that was very difficult to do because especially it happened, in, you know, with in a space where he was supposed to be the person that was supposed to be the example.
Yeah.
So I think that's why it was important that he did apologize. And, you know, he came at dude and I think dude received it overall. You know, whether they agreed, you know, overall about how he came at him. I think overall the whole point was that they were trying to do better for the community.
You know, one other thing I was curious about this episode was Christy's lack of involvement.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, so far this season, she has not been involved in anything. She's not been there. She's
you mean
not,
like outreach-wise?
Outreach-wise, whatever her husband is doing, she's never really there.
Hmm.
Have you noticed that? All of the other first ladies have a very active role in their husband's life and ministry. But every time Jay is going to do anything, Christy just gives him a little hug and says good luck with that.
And doesn't go with him.
See you for dinner tonight.
I think, yeah, I'm thinking about the previous episode. I think you're right. I think a lot of it goes with, I think it's her own insecurities, personally. And the only reason why I say that.
She's insecure.
Well, only reason why I say that is because of the episode that we saw when she was talking about people wanting her to preach.
Right.
And she was like, I don't know if that's my calling. I don't know. I don't want to really go there. And I think that she's insecure about that because when they go out and they do these things, you know, they're preaching, you know, they're ministering to these individuals. When Jay had the young man that was on the street, you know, he was ministering to him. Same thing when they went out, you know, in imperial courts the first time, he was ministering. So I think it may be a situation where she's hesitant because she's
afraid to fully embrace
exactly
what could come out of going to one of she can bake brownies.
she can lend the support, obviously.
I feel like she's supporting from afar this whole season.
She may well be.
I wonder what she spends her time doing now. Like, I'm curious.
Well, what did she was going to be pottery or what pottery. Was it? There was jewelry
fashion,
or something. Right.
Jewelry.
I mean, those are things. I think it's just her heart. I think her heart is for her husband. But I think when it comes down to outreach and ministry, because when we see them in the church, like at the church service, she's there. She's not on, we haven't seen her on the pulpit yet, but you know, when he's ministering, she's there. But I think when it comes down to when he goes out, I think it's just something that it's a separate entity.
Do you think she should play a more active role in the ministry?
I don't want to judge that because I don't know what they have. I mean, they may have an arrangement where that's what he does. When he goes out, maybe he doesn't want her there. I doubt it too. I'm just kind of just playing it just from both sides.
Being generous.
Yeah, I am.
I want to know what you guys think. Do you think Christy should play a more active role in Pastor Jay's ministry? Should she come to those events? Should she start laying hands on people?
Right.
What do you guys think? Let us know. And while you're at it, also check out us on iTunes.
Yes.
Give us 5 stars. Rate, subscribe, leave us comments because we do read them. Let us know what you think. Last week, we got quite a few people that commented on our conversation about Noel and his lady love. A lot of people seem to think that we're going too easy on him. Like
really?
B. Lannister on Twitter seems to think that Lovette is a Loretta. She says Lovette is a Jezebel and a liar, and that we're being way too generous. And then we got Kim Walker on YouTube who says that Bishop Jones and Loretta actually started their relationship for TV only, and Loretta happened to catch feelings in the process of it, which is pretty interesting theories about that because we were really nice to them last week.
We were. I mean, but my thing is, I mean, it goes to being, you have to have a level of respect for these people. It's just like, I feel like and I put this because I grew up in church and I esteem my leaders and people that have, you know, that I'm under when it comes to that. The President of the United States, I may not agree with what he does or says, but I'm not going to disrespect him because he is the president. And that's kind of what I hold in regard to a lot of these pastors and preachers. Yeah, they're putting their stuff out there and doing what they do, but at the same token, I'm not going to bash them because You know, God is their judge. You know, they have to go before God at the end of the day. So
you're so kind and diplomatic.
But I am going to give my opinion.
The rest
still.
Of us out here are going to judge because they want to be judged. That's good ratings if we're judging them harshly.
They are putting it out there. So there it goes.
Jezebels, beware.
So let's talk about Dietrich because aside from the gang summit, he really was the only one that had a story going on. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting because I don't think we had seen anything leading up to this point. You know, he talked to someone from his management team.
Rhoda.
Yes, Rhoda, who about kind of doing some crossover music. And, you know, I've been a fan of Dietrich's music for a while. I actually had the pleasure of opening it from him some years ago.
Whoa, yeah, wait yeah, a minute. Yeah. Do tell.
It was cool.
You sang?
No.
You did some poetry.
I did poetry. Yeah, I did a poem.
Oh, so you know Dietrich all along?
Yeah, I don't know him.
Okay.
But I did open for him.
Is that why you protect him when I call him sneaky?
That is not why.
That's your bread and butter.
No. But it was a cool concert. It was back where I moved here to L.A. from. And it was dope. It was dope. And he did a really good job. And like I said, I've been a fan of his music for years. And I always thought that he was very contemporary already. Mm-hmm. So to me, him talking about, you know, wanting to do crossover, it wasn't a shock because I feel like his music was kind of already at the brink right there. So what did you feel about that when he said that?
I think it's like normal to ruffle feathers whenever you're doing something outside of the box. Mm-hmm. Someone's going to have something to say from it, especially when it's dealing with gospel music. If right. you're straying away from the Negro spiritual, then somebody's not going to like it. A lot of people probably aren't. And Kirk Franklin dealt with that too. He mm-hmm. wanted to go more mainstream. But I was surprised just how mainstream Dietrich is trying to be. Mm. Like, he's going there.
Well, it's interesting because if you look at kind of his trajectory of what's going on, he obviously, you know, he's in the show Heavy. He's the executive producer of this show. He has a new show, Fix My Choir, which is also kind of going into mainstream media, you know, on the Oxygen Network there. And then I think he's doing a lot of other things publicly, becoming more of a public figure. So for me, I think he's trying to just expand his brand. I think it's just a matter, he doesn't want to be pigeonholed in just doing gospel music. He's like, he's, you know, through the medium of TV, television, and other, you know, social media outlets, I feel like he feels like he can break out and kind of have a wider audience. Mm-hmm. And I've seen other people do that. I remember there's a prominent gospel artist who I'm a very good fan of. He's had, you know, tons of albums. And I remember seeing him on The Voice. And he auditioned for The Voice, and his reasoning was because, yeah, he's done gospel concerts, and he's been doing that. I think at that point, he had been doing it 10 years, but he wanted to reach a bigger audience. Not that he would change what his message was about or what he would sing about. He just wanted to reach a different audience.
But your message is going to change when you change your style of music. Like, he wasn't singing about God in that showcase at all.
He was singing about love.
He was singing about love. God is love.
Right. He was singing about love. But,
whatever.
But the thing is there something wrong? Wrong with
there
singing
are
about
dollar
love?
Signs written all over his greedy face. He's EPing two shows. He's the star of this one. He's mm-hmm. the star of the other one. It's obvious that he only wants more money. And he's, you know, he made a note that no gospel singer has sold out a stadium before. Mm-hmm. And he wants to be the first,
he
I guess. And so this is definitely a move motivated by money. I don't know how much is motivated by him wanting to spread the gospel, so he says. I wonder, even if he goes forth with this mainstream route, will he lose some of the gospel within himself? Like, you think he'll stray away from the church at all? Or is that his main thing?
I mean,
I think this is a distraction.
I think historically, maybe not so much in gospel music, but in other like Christian artists, I've seen them cross over. Amy Grant comes to mind. She's more old school. A lot of people may not know about her, but she started off as a Christian artist and she crossed over into, you know, mainstream and pop, and she became a really successful artist, recording artist. Her music wasn't, you know, obviously wasn't Christian, but it wasn't like crazy. You know what I'm saying? It's not like she went over to the deep end and became something that wasn't part of who she was. And my thing is, I think definitely someone can become an artist that is considered more well-rounded, not just the typical gospel genre, that they could cross over and, you know, talk about love. Because at the end of the day, if you're in a relationship, you can be in a guided relationship. You love that person. Do you want to listen? You know, you're getting, you know, in the bedroom. You're married, you know what I'm saying, in the bedroom. Do you want to keep me near the cross? Do you want to hear that? Like, you know what I'm saying? When you're relaxing with your husband?
On the same note, like, I feel like Dietrich is a thin line. He was kind of pelvic thrusting up there on
he
that stage.
He was not pelvic. Oh, see, now you're stretching.
Like, we are almost like
you're
R. Kelly.
Stretching.
Like,
yeah,
he's been,
no,
I
he
don't
was
see
not.
Nothing wrong.
No, he did not. He did not do that. You are making that
he
up.
He is one song away from baby making music.
No,
what did you
no.
think about the new music?
I mean, what they showed us and what I heard, I thought it was cool. I thought it was cool.
You
I
liked
didn't think,
it? You would buy it?
I didn't think, I mean, I'd have to listen to all of it. You know what I'm saying? My thing is, I think that it's good that he is, you know, I mean, you even, like, let's take T.D. Jakes. T.D. Jakes throws on Megafest, and he has jazz artists there. He has, I mean, a lot of secular different artists that are there that perform, that's part of this whole, and he's a bishop, you know what I'm saying? But he puts this on, and the whole thing is that it's nothing is crazy, you know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, he still allows that to be part of what he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
I think the whole thing is, if you're doing music, it should be good music, you know what I'm saying? And it's not like there's a lot of people who listen to gospel music that don't just listen to gospel music. Why not give them something else that they could listen to that they don't have to worry about feeling like, oh my gosh, what did he say? You know, like an artist like, you know, who you just mentioned earlier. Do you see what I'm saying?
Like
so,
R. Kelly.
Yeah. So my thing is, I'm all for it. I mean, and I think it was good that, you know, the person he was told, who's the management?
Rhoda.
Thank you. I think it was good that she said, make sure you get a hit.
Right.
Don't just be like, okay, I'm gonna do secular music, and then it's whack.
Yeah.
Because then you're really gonna tank, and then you're gonna lose your gospel fans, and then you're not gonna have any new secular fans or what have you. So I think a lot of times people do that, and it's been said of Mary Mary, the same thing. Mary Mary has been very contemporary their whole time, but a lot of their music, they've done songs with secular artists. They've, you know, their music has been crossed over and played in secular realms. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And their message is still there. So, I mean,
what I didn't like to see was so much all the resistance that he got about this new idea. Like, his manager was mm-hmm. like, pump the brakes on that. Mm-hmm. Dominique was like, aren't you scared they're going to say you sold out? Like,
right.
I hate that. Be supportive,
yeah.
people. I hate when creative people have a hunch. Let them follow that hunch. Like,
right.
he has not, it has not steered him wrong yet.
Right.
So
right.
I trust his decision making. And there is something to be said about branching out to people that don't normally see you.
Right.
That is how you grow your audience. If you're doing the same thing all the time,
mm-hmm.
no one's going to see you. So I think that's also the beauty of the Preachers of L.A. TV show,
mm-hmm.
the different people that they're getting through reality TV, even though T.D. Jakes turns his nose up at it, it's
right.
working.
Right.
You got me. I would not be touching that with a 10-foot pole.
Exactly.
Otherwise. So I think that he has, you know, a, mm-hmm. something on his mind, and I think that it's going to turn out nicely for him.
Absolutely. So we will see. So that being said, let's get into predictions.
Predictions.
Let's kind of talk about that, and that's a great segue.
Yep.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
So first off, I'm going to predict that Dietrich Haddon will be the next R. Kelly. Making baby-making
oh
music.
My gosh,
and
no.
it's going to be very successful, and we're going to hear his rise to fame all over again.
That's a prediction.
That story.
Oh, gosh. Okay, so I think that we will see a little bit more, you know, talking about the music. I think we'll see more about that. I think what he may be doing, especially because he is using this show as a platform, he may be looking at, you know, releasing a secular album that would be like before the show ends that, you know, can be produced, you know what I'm saying, promoted. So I think that that's well on his way to kind of people want to see his fans now. And then the new fans, because like you said, you wouldn't be watching the show otherwise. Some of the people that watch the show never heard of him.
Right.
So now they're like, oh, I want to hear what his music is going to sound like. Something sounds good. So I think he's going to definitely go into that, and I think we're going to see more with going back into our other characters that we didn't see, which is Noel Jones
yeah.
and Loretta. I think we're going to, that part still isn't fixed yet. I think there's going to be some more with that whole relationship dynamic and everything that's going on with that.
There's a lot of healing that has to happen. We
yeah.
also see Jay go back to Alabama. Looks like he's
yes.
going to be mending a relationship
yeah.
with his mother. That
yeah.
should be interesting. I
that
saw tears.
Yeah, and he had talked about his mother. He had him at 15.
Yeah.
So he did mention that this episode. So should be very interesting. Make sure you tune in. And that is the end of this show. Make sure you tune in next week and be back here with us. Preachers of L.A. I'm your host, Lim Gonsalvez, and you can always find me on social media on Twitter and Instagram at The Poet Saint. Tiff, where
and
can they find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Tiffs with a Z, Tweets with a Z.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a good night. We'll see you next week.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.